Folks, today we are going to learn about craft beer in Baja. Beer, 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 and more beer. Coming to you now. You know, Baja California has already established itself as the go-to place for wine in Mexico. But now it's adding another libation to that claim. Ah, yes. Who doesn't enjoy some suds, right? But these are not commercial beers. These are craft artisanal beers. So we travel to Ensenada to meet one of the beer rabble-rousers of the region. This brewery is called Wendland. Okay, so according to the people in the know, there's no way you can talk about craft beer in Baja without mentioning these guys from Wendland and this guy right here. How are you doing, my friend?
Good, how are you?
What's your name?
Eugenio.
Eugenio.
Si.
Eugenio, are you the guy? Are you the Wendland guy?
I am the Wendland guy.
How'd you come up with the name? Talk to me about the name.
It's my last name.
What?
Yes.
Did you say you were Romero?
Romero, I'm Romero Wendland.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where is it from?
It's originally from Germany, but I'm full Mexican.
I heard you won a prize, like best tasting beer of Mexico or something. What's going on?
Yes, last year, so there's a beer competition throughout Mexico.
Okay.
And we won 5 medals.
So You're kidding, 5 medals?
Yes.
So in all of Mexico?
Yes.
So where is the competition? Where was it held?
In Mexico City. It's every year.
So you try. Baja California is just like a dark horse, right?
Yeah.
Coming out of nowhere.
Exactly. We started as a brew pub. Downtown Ensenada, people really liked it. What we were brewing, we were only brewing a pale ale.
Okay.
That's what we used to do. And then we just brewed it and it was always running out. So we have to brew more and more and more until we decided, you know what? We have to take that brewery and put more tables there.
Yeah.
Because the bar became very popular and we took the brewery out of there and then we just grew here. And
across the border from Baja California is the craft beer capital of the States, San Diego. Couldn't help wonder if there was a relation. Are you guys influenced at all by the San Diego craft beer movement?
Definitely.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
it was a formal question. I had to ask.
Yeah, I went to San Diego State.
Okay.
So that's where I picked up my...
You started tasting good beer over there.
Exactly. Because I grew up here tasting 2 beers, you know? And then...
Can we mention on TV as the names of the 2 Mexican ones?
Yeah.
A beer like this has kick and it engages your taste buds.
Our pale ale is dry hop, very West Coast style.
Very hoppy.
Yes. Our red ale is also dry hopped. Our IPA is dry hopped.
Okay.
So we picked up a lot of influence from the West Coast, the US.
Mm-hmm.
We like the bittering hops, the very aromatic hops. So we dry hop and we do late hop additions through most of our beers.
Okay.
And so a lot of the brewers from San Diego have been very, very helpful.
They've been supportive with you guys?
Very supportive.
That's awesome.
From beer bars to brewers to industry people, just they're super friendly and
Are you starting to sell your stuff over there?
We are. We are selling in Southern California.
Nice.
So
your lightest beer would be equivalent to what?
To a blonde ale.
A blonde ale.
Pretty much our blonde ale, and then we...
So it's still better than a Corona or anything like that, right?
Dude, come on.
What's he gonna say? No! Okay, let's try this stuff. Yeah, definitely. Oh, and it does have a little bit of bitterness, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah, it's not fizzy yellow water.
No, it's not, my friend. Oh, wow. You know what? I think I'd been missing that balance between a beer that was refreshing,
mm-hmm.
like for the summer,
yeah.
and hoppy at the same time. Very nice. Oh my goodness. I have German friends who would like to taste this.
We're gonna try the Vaquita Marina, which is our pale ale.
It's a pale ale.
It's a pale ale. It's been dry hopped also.
Okay.
So it's more aromatic and a little bit more bitter. The one before.
It has a little bit more bitterness,
yes.
but it's not overwhelming.
No, it's a 5% alcohol beer and has 40 IBUs, so A little bit bitter.
So 40 are the units of bitterness, right?
Yep.
So what would, like, your most bitter beer, how many IBUs does that have?
That has 65.
This is 40, that would be 65.
Yeah.
So, like, in what's the average IBUs in San Diego beer, style beer?
Well, some people go crazy and do like 100, over 100. I just believe in well-balanced
beers. And not killing your taste buds.
But
preserving them for future taste.
Yeah, exactly. But they're fun. Just try, you know?
It seems like Baja is leading the way in all of Mexico. Is that accurate?
Yes, it is.
That's crazy. I mean, from non-existent to number one, how does that happen?
It's the influence that we have from San Diego has to be a part of it.
I think Tijuana and Baja and Ensenada, everyone, they're saying, thank you, San Diego. You
know? Exactly. Yes, I really believe, because all the support that I've had from San Diego, it's been amazing.
Okay.
That San Diego is so close and they're so cool to tell us, like, oh, this is how we do it.
You don't have to fly to get this influence, right?
Exactly. In San Diego, we have one of the best labs in the world, probably, White Labs.
And you guys use that?
Exactly.
That's awesome.
So, I mean, that's so convenient. We only do in Mexico restaurants and bars.
That's what you do right now?
Yeah. The philosophy of this brewery is just everything's with the beer before marketing, before anything buying or selling or whatever.
It's good,
man. It's just beer, 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 and then...
You're a purist. That's true.
Let's see where the beer takes us.
It's Wetland beer, man. If you need them, let me finish this beer right here. This is good stuff.
Like many industries previously foreign to Baja California, the making of craft beer is still in its infancy. And though a handful are ahead of the curve, the potential and market is pretty much still wide open. So entrepreneurs, big and small, feel emboldened to give it a go.
So folks, you know, we talked about how some of these brewers that are already established right now, many of them started, you know, in their kitchens and just a dream and the desire, the passion, then a little knowledge, a little help from someone, and boom, brewing beer in Mexico. One of such people is the one that makes this beer right here. This Lagos beer is made by this guy right here, Cesar Lagos. How did you get into this?
The love of beer, you know?
Yeah.
And
so that's the first check, number one. I love beer, right?
Yeah. So and for me is basically brewing beer is like cooking.
Okay.
You do it like a big soup.
Right.
And take some precautions and be very, very clean in your whole procedure.
Okay.
And a little of chemistry, and you have yourself a beer. So. And how I came into this is, okay, I like beer, I want to learn how to brew beer, and worst case scenario, I drink my own beer, right?
It's not a bad worst case scenario.
Right? So, and that has been changing. I think I made my first batch in September of 2012. Made several batches after that. Right now I'm going to school in the professional brewing program at UCSD in San Diego. So the thought process is to take it to the next level and probably open a business, probably a tasting room or something bigger than that. It doesn't take much money to brew your own beer. I think that is very important. A couple of $100 will buy you a starter kit and you take it from there. And most of the time starts as a hobby. And people that are very good home brewers never take that next step because they don't want to.
Okay.
This is nothing they're looking for, and some do. So
the whole concept of buying local has been catching on for a while. You know, the hipsters, millennials, newer generations.
And it's not that it's better or worse, but it's ours.
It's ours, right. So where do you get all your beer making kits?
I basically went into Homebrew Mart, which is owned by Ballast Point, and said, you know what? I want to learn how to make beer. So I bought everything and...
You just did it and you saw it in paper?
I saw it in paper, but it took me a month to do it, you know? Because to say, okay, what's the worst that could happen? I can... bad beer, okay.
Yeah.
What we're gonna do right now is We need to take that airlock out. So just take it out, put it on the side. And now this is going to help us transfer the liquid from our carboy here. So put it inside. And what we're looking to do is not only transfer, but eliminate as much solids in the process. If you take a look, they're mostly...
The sediments in the bottom?
Correct.
So that's the yeast, right?
Correct.
See, I was thinking I was going to bear hug this jug and just pour it down there like that.
So, see, now we're transferring.
So is this what's going to give it the bubbles?
Well, the bubbles will come from mixing both the beer with water and corn sugar. So we need to transfer all 5 gallons to this.
So just stir it?
Yeah. We'll just stir it every so often just to make sure the sugar is everywhere.
I think this is the, it's like traveling back in time and seeing some of the, you know, how the brewers that are already, you know, established started.
You can just imagine a time when the home brewer was the precursor for major beer brands we know of today. That sense of accomplishment, of enjoyment for making a product you like, it's back. Individuals like Caesar are looking to rediscover what was already there, but for a new generation and a new type of beer.
You got it down.
Put this on tap, on top, and crank it down both sides. Push down. It doesn't take much effort till it pops. There you go, and just take it out.
Wow.
Yeah, it's done.
I did it! I capped my first bottle. Super cool. So the poor bottle's going, oh, good, 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 good. And there you go. The touch. Is that cool?
Yeah, that's good.
Glug.
So I'll cut this one for you.
Do it, man. Do it!
There you go. As easy as 1, 2, 3. So you need to be regulated. You need to pay taxes. 40-some% of your total price is you lose in taxes.
Oh, my
goodness. That's tough when...
You sell 100 pesos, 40 is theirs.
Correct.
Wow, that's a lot. That's a lot. Let me see if I can open it. No, just kidding.
And I have some labels there.
So these, you leave them like that in the bottle still until?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. And then you put them in the fridge.
Correct.
This is how it looks. Minus the CO2, minus the yeast farts, minus the bubbles that are happening. How long will it take to have bubbles and you know, the carbonated?
2 weeks in a bottle.
2 weeks in a bottle.
Yeah.
You know how in a pool you can tell when somebody's, yeah, that's the bubbles you drink.
The jacuzzi effect.
The natural jacuzzi. Well, this is flat, so they haven't had time to actually bubble forth. So let's see how it tastes. Flat beer. Wow. You know what? It's a strong beer. It is a little bit fruity, right?
Peaches. You get some.
Yeah.
Peaches in there.
Fruity, a little bit bitter, but just a little bit. You just put a little bitterness.
Correct.
You know, Caesar, this is a good thing.
Do you want to put some labels on these?
Let's do it, man. Let's do it. I'm your employee for today.
Okay.
I'm like,
so just do it like this, and then take it all the way around. Let's see how you did in kindergarten with the arts and crafts.
Unfortunately, I didn't do very good, so I hope I didn't slaughter your first bottle here.
So it came out a little bit crooked.
Crooked. Incredibly crooked. Is that are you going to leave it like that?
You get to keep that one.
Take this home. I'm sorry. Pretty pathetic. You know, I wasn't very good at arts and crafts. You know. Okay, so we've done the whole process with Cesar. We helped him bottle a few beers, label a few of them. Well, this is the finished product right here. Look at it. Glistening with all the condensation from the coldness. We're going to open one of these, and the one's going to help me is my little wrestler friend right here. It's going to apply the Stilson. Little move here. Come on, grr, yield. Say uncle. There you go. Right there. All joking aside, folks, this is a very good beer. Very good taste. A nice alternative to the heavy hop, heavy bitter San Diego style craft beer. But even this may not have been possible was it not for the beer enthusiast community of San Diego.
This is really good beer. This is really good beer for, I really think you got something going here. Are you taking any, accepting any investors? Any?
Of course, always.
Stock options?
Always.
This, I know you'll hear from this beer again, my friends. So, Cesar, my little friend here, and say hello to my little friend, and me, will enjoy this beer, but don't go anywhere. More questions are coming your way. There's more to come, folks. Man,
this fledgling subculture of Baja California beer makers is making it their own. They're trying to explode into the mainstream, and you know what? They're succeeding. A clear example of that are these guys.
We just bought a homebrew kit, started making beer in our mom's kitchen. And just
that's kind of, how it started.
That's how it started.
Literally,
yeah.
That's how it started.
Yeah, it's literally out of the kitchen. So she kicked us out of the kitchen at one point, sent us to the garage. We outgrew the garage pretty quickly. And
oh
then
my goodness.
We had started winning medals and getting some recognition
You're
here and there.
Kidding.
And we started selling in Mexico City, Guadalajara, Monterrey, and places like this. Very small volumes compared to now because we were doing it all
but
by
hand.
But
you were traveling to these places.
Well, not so much traveling, really. It's just word got around. Those first initial customers are now our biggest distributors. So they grew along with us in a way. This building didn't exist.
You built it?
Yeah, we built it for the brewery. So this was just an empty lot 5 years ago.
The team behind Insurgentes Beer is that of two siblings. Also influenced by San Diego brewers, they took a chance on a population that didn't even know craft beer existed.
Okay, so you poured me a beer that's just coming out tomorrow.
Yeah.
And on an August scorcher like today.
Yeah.
This smells and feels very good. So
it's very flavorful, but it's also very, very light. The Saison style is known for being sort of a very simple ingredient kind of beer. It only uses the most basic malts, you know,
it's just very refreshing.
Malt. Yeah. And most of the flavor comes from the actual fermentation itself.
Okay.
It's the yeast that gives it that nice fruity, spicy flavor. I do think we are a big beer culture. It's just a matter of introducing people to new flavors. And I think once you go craft, you never go back.
Right, exactly.
We started exporting into the States in January of 2015. And really, it's just Southern California so far.
So how's that going?
It's going great, actually.
Really?
It's going really, really great. Last year, it was one of our bigger markets.
No way.
So, I mean, it's just the fact that people in San Diego consume so much beer that it's obscene. So Fauna from Mexicali, Wendland, Wendland and Aguamala from Ensenada and Border Cycle here from Tijuana are also exporting.
So it's like four or five brewers that are already exporting to the States.
Yes. Good. We're actually already exporting to Panama, to Denmark, and then Costa Rica probably in the next couple months.
So you're interested in world domination, basically.
I'm pinky in the brain.
You wanted to get this to be everywhere.
We definitely look at the US a lot for as a point of reference, and that's helped us a lot in our growth as an industry. Like, we're growing very, very quickly because we know what to do because the US already did it.
Well, my friend, you're doing a good job and this is really good beer. So thank you for talking to us.
Thank you, man.
It's Crossing Southwest, don't go anywhere. We have more to show and Insurgentes is certainly a special place to consider.
So all these brewers, big and small, pros and enthusiasts, if there was only one place where you could find them all together, and you can. Welcome to Plaza Fiesta in Tijuana's Zona Rio. This place has been reborn as the hub in Baja where craft beer converges.
A lot of homebrews started doing their own thing. And they actually got together and then just share beers with their friends, with a bunch of neighbors. It was a couple of years ago, a bunch of homebrews got together and they made like this little festival. And they kind of like moved aside from the big companies and it blew up. Their atmosphere, it's not really competitive. It's like they know everybody.
They have a brotherhood.
It's like a brotherhood. Down here in the plaza, you have breweries from Mexicali, Ensenada, And they're coming from everywhere. They know the scene in TJ is like really strong. We enjoy beer and we like drinking it.
Yeah.
And we wanted people to know what beer is all about.
Right.
And there was nothing there. There was nothing to actually
not
tell
even a
you.
Blog.
We're trying to educate people. And there was a lot of people that didn't drink craft beer. There's actually people that look at us funny at first when the whole movement started, because we were drinking out of a glass and everybody was drinking out of a bottle. And they would go like, what are you guys doing? We're like, tasting real beer, not what you're drinking. And now it's like weird to see somebody with an actual...
Yes,
with an actual bottle going like, yeah, I'm drinking beer at the plaza. No, you're not drinking beer at the plaza, you're drinking water.
You're water, exactly.
Most of the beers are sipping beers. You get a non-craft beer and you have to drink it like fast, because once it gets to a certain temperature, a high temperature, it stales out, you can't drink it, it tastes horrible.
Okay.
And there's beers that you can actually leave there, talk to your friends, leave it 30 minutes, 20 minutes.
Still have body, right?
And it's still, the flavor is still there. Yeah. You still see people like getting really hammered because most of them don't know that they're actually drinking higher alcohol in their beers. And then you go like, sure, I'll just have like three glasses of this and 9%, 10%, even 12. We've seen a couple of them with 15.
Oh my goodness. And
you gotta be really careful.
And I actually started in the Tijuana Homebrew Club, just like an observer. I don't brew and I don't want to brew it because it's a job that I respect and I don't want to go there. I just want to do my thing and talk about beer, taste it. Hey, we just want to let you know what we think about this beer. Then you go to the tasting room and taste it, and then you tell us what you think. There's beer for everyone. Maybe if we don't like this beer, maybe you'll like it, or maybe him, or maybe her. We want to share what's happening in Tijuana about craft beer. Everyone wants to have a tasting room in here, and the ones that don't have already, they want to be in here. Tijuana is finding like his own style. I think, in a personal point of view, that the Tijuana style is like an experimental style. With fruits, with spices, with whatever you want.
It's still evolving.
Yes, it's still evolving and it's still trying to find its style.
People from across the border are taking notice.
The face of microbreweries in Tijuana is, you know, it's gonna grow and it's gonna be an exciting time for Tijuana. I think that San Diego and other areas in the region are gonna be pretty excited about what they have to offer. I think it's important that TJ takes subtle steps. You know, there's one thing about growing fast, but the other time you want to grow at the right speed. You have a big community down here that love beer, that love craft beer.
Where can it go?
Just like in San Diego, you've seen some big name microbreweries, you know, Ballast Point. You know, you have some big distributions that have bought it out, you know, for quite a bit of money, you know, in the billions. So the same thing can happen here in Tijuana. The craft beer industry, it's a labor of love. You do it not to get rich, but you do it because you love the craft, you love what's involved in it, you love the camaraderie, the peoples. And so it's definitely something that's embracing, and you know, you just fall in love with it. You know, you want to be a part of it.
You sure do. People like Ren are coming from the States to see what's going on in Baja. And we were happy to take a peek into it and wonder what will await us the next time we cross south.
There you go.
Like to know more about the places you've just seen? Maps, videos, podcasts, and more at crossingsouth.com. We also do Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube.